This chapter, Wings Over Kitty Hawk. The story of Wilbur and Orville Wright. In the beginning, there were the birds. From earliest times, men sought to emulate their flight. Legendary Icarus made wings of feathers and wax. They carried him to destruction. Leonardo da Vinci inherited the dangerous dream in 15th century Italy. He made sketches of devices with which he hoped men would soar like the winged creatures of the air. Da Vinci never flew, but he was a genius far in advance of his time, indicating the principles of modern aviation. The next step was taken in 18th century France. Desrosiers, a daredevil, went up in a balloon constructed by the brothers Montgolfier. Man thus broke his links to the earth. The dream of flight had become a reality. Balloons were far from Da Vinci's vision of bird-like flight. To solve that problem, new geniuses were needed. However, balloons were useful. During the American Civil War, Thaddeus Lowe built a balloon from which he sketched the first aerial reconnaissance maps in military history. Then back to the concept of wings. Lilienthal in Germany and Chanute in America proved that men could soar like birds, but they failed to uncover the basic secrets of aviation. That task remained for Wilbur and Orville Wright. The brothers had little education, little money for experiments, but they had genius. In their bicycle shop, they made a glider. Twisting a bit of paper, they realized the glider's wings could be made to tilt to the wind in the same way as birds. Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. The Wright brothers came here in 1901 to test their new glider. It didn't fly well. They left Kitty Hawk discouraged. In December 1903, they returned. 2 years of feverish work had solved the mysteries of lift and control of motors and propellers. Orville won the toss to decide which would fly first and became the first human ever to pilot an airplane. Few newspapers printed the announcement of the historic flight. Most editors scoffed. At that time, the president of the United States was Theodore Roosevelt. The Wright brothers offered their invention to Roosevelt's War Department. Officials refused to believe their claims. The airplane was turned down. But in France, the Wrights were famous. Kings and prime ministers were at the field when Wilbur demonstrated the plane near Paris. He won medals and prizes. Almost simultaneously, after Teddy Roosevelt intervened, a demonstration was made for the United States Army. If the plane flew 10 miles and met other qualifications, the Army would buy it for $25,000. Only a few Americans had ever seen an airplane when Orville Wright started the engine. Some eminent scientists still claimed human flight was impossible. Accompanied by an Army officer, Orville took the pilot seat. For the Army, it was the beginning of a great Air Force. For the Wright brothers, it was recognition after years of ridicule and scorn. For the onlookers, some of whom wept with emotion, it was a breathtaking miracle. A year later, the Wright Airplane Company was formed. Soon, new names were added to the roster of American airmen. Glenn Curtiss gave the world its first hydroplane. In France, Louis Blériot, a friend and admirer of the Wrights, prepared for a flight across the English Channel. He took off without a compass, setting a course for the cliffs of Dover. A man with wings obliterating national boundaries, it was a hint of things to come. Then, with the death of Wilbur Wright in 1912, a tragic setback for aviation. Orville sold the company crushed by his loss. They had been inseparable. Now he was alone. Then came the First World War. Foot soldiers might go on marching, but this war was different from any previous war in history, made more deadly by the presence of aircraft in the sky. Machine guns chattered over the lines as the airplane met its rival, the balloon, and proved its superiority. Bombers took off with cargoes of destruction. Orville Wright, now an American Air Force major, had thought the airplane would bring peace to the world. Yet there was one consolation. In the war, men had grown their wings. The war ended in the bright dawn of the air age. With the end of the war, the world went air-minded, plunged into a period of wild experiments. To Orville Wright, still grieving the death of his brother, the parade of fantastic machines that would never fly seemed like a mockery of their great invention. It was a field day for crackpot inventors. Men imitated the Greek legend of Icarus with results more ludicrous than tragic. But Orville didn't laugh at the clowns. The experiments could be deadly. Men of courage gave their lives in payment for scientific knowledge. In airplanes and gliders, they rode their wings to disaster. But out of it came progress. Charles Lindbergh, in 1927, took off alone on a flight to France. In Paris, huge crowds turned out to greet the Lone Eagle, first human to span the Atlantic nonstop. 2 weeks before, the Frenchmen Nongesse and Colley attempted to fly the Atlantic in the opposite direction, from Paris to New York. They were lost in the ocean. With a plane named for the ill-fated pair, another Paris to New York flight was attempted successfully by Coste and Belanti. In 1928, the Pacific was spanned by air for the first time by an Australian, Kingsford Smith. That year was the 25th anniversary of the Wrights' first flight. With Amelia Earhart and other famous flyers present, Orville was honored at Kitty Hawk. It was a bitter, sweet moment. For Orville, the ceremony was tinged with sorrow. If only Wilbur could be here to share in the glory. More honors. In 1929, the Distinguished Flying Cross for the achievement at Kitty Hawk. Meanwhile, man's wings kept shrinking the earth. Post and Getty circled the world in 8 days. Unable to foresee her own tragic end, Amelia Earhart predicted the day when wings would make the people of the world neighbors. Orville shared that dream. He spoke of it in 1938 with Henry Ford, another pioneer of aviation. The vision was interrupted by the realities of World War II. With President Roosevelt in 1940, Orville inspected the new army planes at Wright Field. Orville had played an important part in the development since Kitty Hawk. After his brother's death, he had invented the split-wing flaps for modern fighting planes. Streaking over German skies, manned by a new generation of brave Americans, the bombers sped through nightmares of flak to reach their targets. Millions of tons of high explosives poured down to cripple German industries, backbone of the Nazi war machine. Speedy fighter planes strafed the enemy's lines of communication. They created havoc behind the front. Air power, gift of the Wright brothers, the decisive factor in the free world's fight for survival against the Nazis. Reviewing troops in 1945, Orville Wright expected great peacetime progress. The age of jet propulsion had arrived. Seventy-four years old, Wright had lived to see planes develop into sleek monsters, flying hundreds of miles per hour. Faster and faster they flew, aiming for a new goal, the sound barrier. Meanwhile, civilian air transport had kept pace. Orville's vision of peaceful wings for mankind had come true beyond his wildest dreams. The new airliners provided luxuries that dazzled the old pioneer. man's wings had welded the Earth into a single unit. The distance between New York and Paris and Tokyo could now be reckoned in hours. Modern wings cast their shadow over the ancient pyramids and over the Alaskan wilds. Then came January 1948, and Orville Wright passed away. He and his brother left behind a staggering heritage. They had given to mankind the most destructive weapon of war, short of the atomic bomb. But the huge planes were also cargo carriers, a blessing in peacetime. Troop-carrying helicopters could also carry passengers and airmail. Screaming across the sky to smash the sound barrier, the new jet-propelled planes could become instruments of life or death, depending on how men used them. At Kitty Hawk stands a monument to Wilbur and Orville Wright. Here, for the first time with success, men spread their wings and fluttered feebly into the sky. 50 years later, men had gone on to explore the realms beyond, into the dizzy heights of space, onward toward the planets. There lies the new course for brave men with wings. Up there is the everlasting monument to Wilbur and Orville Wright.